Did you change any of your flats too?
I did.
So that's record and then that's not recording. Yep. Okay. And then
out of our mouth. Are we breathing from our diaphragm? Using our muscles in the rib cage? Are we breathing from our neck muscles? Where do all these things come into play? And how you breathe has a huge impact on your posture. The next one is axial elongation core control. That seems like very medical, very technical, all sorts of things. The point is being long and tall. So if you think of a slinky, if the slinky is compressed, it doesn't work out very well, but if the slinky works well, it goes down the stairs very nicely. But if the slinky has a bend in it, that doesn't work anymore, and it's not a very fun toy anymore. So the idea is to be as long and as tall and using this middle. Then we go on to spinal articulation. So how does our spine move in all the directions it should? So when we talk about proper posture, we have to think about not just how we are static, but how are we when we move? How's everything positioning and how's everything on top of one another? So how does that impact our posture and what we're using? Organization of the head, neck, and shoulders. So what happens up here affects all of this. So I want to do a little test here. I want everybody to kind of sit, kind of slouch. Just let others like, oh, thank goodness. Uh-oh. Hold on. Okay, so when you're here, everybody stay here. Now smile. Feels kind of funny. Okay, it's kind of hard. It kind of like, yeah. Now sit up tall. So I want you to think of your breastbone lifting up tall. I want your backs all the way, your legs all the way against the back of your chair. Now try to frown here. That feels good too. So in a sense, the better posture we have, the happier people we are. So the point being is that all of these things, everything sets one thing up to another. So as we have this other part of our body organized, if we're slouched, it just sets everything else down from there. Then we talk about weight-bearing alignment of the extremities. So when we stand and when we're sitting, how are our feet positioned? What is our, where's our weight on our feet? Where is it not on our feet? If we're wearing heels, if we're not wearing heels, how does that impact the rest of our body? And the last one is movement integration. How do all of these things go into play, and how can we think about these or not think about things? So when it comes to learning, there's a little learning matrix that was established in the 1970s. And the learning matrix goes like this. We start with being unconsciously incompetent. We don't know what we don't know. Then all of a sudden we become consciously competent. Now we know we don't know it. Usually in my first physical therapy session with somebody, I've gotten them through those first two sessions. They come in not knowing, and then they leave, wow, I was totally unaware of that. Then the next part is then we bring them consciously competent. Now they know it. They're conscious of it. Then we want to move to unconscious competence. Because you shouldn't be that every single day you're having to think, okay, my shoulders back, my head up, draw the suit, pull these, okay, now it's my legs, oh, unlock, do all this. If you have to go through all of those every single time, you're not getting anything done. So the point is that the better we are positioned, the more than all these other things, and you feel more about when things aren't right versus I have to work really hard to make them correct. So this movement integration is that principle of getting all of these things into play and knowing what these things are. How many of you in here have taken a Pilates session with Marie or a class? Yeah? Do you remember your very first one when she asked you to breathe and to think about where your head was, keep your pelvis in neutral, and keep your shoulders away from your ears, and now we're going to do an exercise? And all of a sudden you're like, okay, wait a minute, that's way too many things to think about. But think about now when you do some of the movements, you don't have to think about all of those things all the time. She might key you in a little bit here, a little bit there, but now they're starting to be integrated into your body that way. So let's look at here. These are some common postures by Florence Kendall from her book. So the first one is good posture. So it's a good old in PT school plumb line. So a nice line going down. It goes through right behind the ear, right at the tip of the shoulder, right at the outer part of the hip, so your greater trochanter, and then right in front of the ankle bone. Now the next one is the posture where it's that person that's a little bit rounded here and a little bit rounded there. So this could be somebody that's pregnant. This could just be somebody that was involved in gymnastics. So as a child, I was in gymnastics for a lot, so I thought I was standing up straight like this with my bum sticking out. So just learning that, oh, that's too far. Then the sway back, which is much harder for me to do, but it kind of slouched. And so I lost about 2 inches just coming right in there. So We want to make sure we keep ourselves as tall as possible. And then the flat back, you can see in that picture, there's not much curve at all. It's kind of like the spine's nice and flat. So when we became, as we're standing on both feet, that curve of our back, where we have that little in, little out, little in, helps us to stay upright. If we lose that, then all of a sudden there's other stresses on the spine as far as they're stacked from there. So that's just some pictures of that posture. So what is good posture? We're going to talk about what it is for the feet, the knees, the hips, the pelvis, chest, shoulders, and head and neck. So this first slide, I have a picture of feet. As they turn out, those are actually my feet. So which one looks correct? So we'll take a little vote. So look at the pictures. How many think we'll take the one furthest over to that side of the room? How many think that one is correct? And we got one, two, three, four, got a few. How many think the one in the middle is correct? Good majority. How many think the one on the end is correct? So if we look at them, the one in the middle is the correct one. The one in the first one, I was taking my feet and rolling them inward. So if everybody kind of takes, if you have heels on, if you feel comfortable to take them off, please do. If not, no big deal. But if everybody just takes their feet and sitting and just roll more towards the big toe side of your foot. And some people may be like, well, I'm already there. That's just what their foot structure is like. That's the pronated foot. Now, when that happens, when I'm standing, I've got to adjust all sorts of things up my body. My knees start coming together. I've got to change where my pelvis is. Everything's got to line because the body wants to be efficient and it wants everything to line up well. So if our base starts different, it's going to change everything up above. Now we're going to take their feet and roll to the outer part of their foot. So that's this picture on this far left side, your right. That's supination. So that's too much going to the outside of the foot. So our ideal alignment for our feet is that we have equal pressure on the ball of the foot, underneath the base of the big toe, and between the fourth and the fifth toe. So not so much all the way to the little toe, but between the fourth and fifth ones. And we keep a little bit more pressure to the front of the foot than to the back. So it's a 60-40 from there. So if we start that base there, then all of a sudden we start lining up things from there. So we'll go ahead and we'll go over that a little bit more, but I wanted to show those pictures for that base. And we go up to our knees. So if you look at the two pictures, how many think the one on the left-hand side of the room looks the best? How many people think the one on the right-hand side of the room looks the best? Yeah? So the problem with the one on the left-hand side of the room is that her legs are too straight. So some people have the ability to hyperextend their knees, so meaning go beyond that zero up and down. Not everybody has that potential, but some people do. And so the idea, if we stand too far straight, then our weight goes back too far on our heels, then we have to adjust in our back, and so forth and so forth. Again, our bones are best when they're lined up directly in those lines on top of one another, and if that happens, the muscles don't have to work that hard. So everything structurally is lined up well. It's one of my co-workers, Christine, demonstrating that. So what is proper sitting posture? So everybody's sitting in their chair, but now what I want you to do is slide your chair back just a little bit so you have some space. And I want everybody to scoot forward in their chair, kind of so that your back is not against the back of the chair. So give yourself a little space. So what everybody do is take their hands and put them on their pelvis. So that's right in here. Everybody kind of thinks their hips are this. This is the bowl of the pelvis. So if we think of that pelvis, it's a nice soup bowl. This pelvis can go forward, which makes our back curve a little bit. And it goes back, and we spill the soup going back the other way. So just kind of move that way, just within the range that you feel comfortable. So we want to no discomfort in the back, no discomfort otherwise. We just want to rock that bolt back and forth. And what you should feel is there's two little bones that we sit on called our ischial tuberosities, and we should sit right on them. We all have them, I promise. So once you sit on them, that bowl should be stationed exactly upright so we keep our soup. Then once that happens, then you want to look down at your thighs. Are your thighs straight out? Are your knees slightly below your hips? Or are your knees above your hips? If our knees are above our hips, then our chair is too low. So we want to make sure that those knees are a little bit below or straight in line. then those feet are firmly planted on the ground. So yes, that's not properly like sitting with both feet planted on the ground. We could do a little ankle cross or we cross our legs. But as we do those, that causes potentially a twist in the back. So if we keep both feet firmly planted and those legs together, we can do a little cross at the ankles, and that still keeps everything in line. Then as we go through, the next thing we want to talk about is we've got that pelvis. We want to kind of think as we go up, we've got our rib cage. So on our rib cage, just kind of put your hands on either side of your rib cage. So your thumbs slightly to the back, fingers slightly to the front. So you ever feel how that rib cage is smaller than the opening of your pelvis. So just kind of make that little thing there. So we kind of have these little tubes in our body. So if we think about the bones, we have the rib cage tube that sits inside the pelvis tube. So if I stand or sit like this, my rib cage tube is too far in front of my pelvis tube. So I want to try to get that rib cage tube inside. Now my biggest tube are my shoulders. So if you think of your shoulders as making a big circle all the way around, harder to think of because they go side to side, but if you think of that same distance front to back, now I have that shoulder tube as an umbrella over top of your rib cage, which is over top of your pelvis. So all of these tubes, so if I have my shoulders like this, now my shoulder tube is not quite over top of everything. So thinking about these nice tubes and these nice circles allows us to think, okay, how does everything line up? So if we have our feet firmly planted on the ground, we have that weight on those sits bones, we have that ribcage tube inside the pelvis tube, what that does is it turns on the muscles in your belly. And what I want you to think about here is that your belly muscles make a line of Y. So the top of the Y comes from one ribcage and the other ribcage to your belly button. The bottom of the Y is the pubic bone skin pulling up towards the belly button. So everything on top feels like it's coming together. Now the hard part with that, I say that and everybody thinks they want to go like this. Now we've lost our tubes. So we still keep those tubes as we pull that skin in. Now we keep that skin drawn in as if there's like a little space between your pants and your skin. Then we want to take that breastbone and feel like it's lifting up a little bit higher. This is where we start getting our axial elongation. So that point that we're lifting a little bit higher. Now when everybody take their hand and put it on the top of their head, whichever hand feels best. Now just find that spot, and now I want you to imagine there's a string from that spot to the ceiling. And you're being pulled up by that string towards the ceiling. Now we get the head, that next line of axial elongation. So everything is centered, and relax that hand down. And the challenge is, we want to be like, feel like this feels normal. And for some of you, this feels odd. Feels like it's a lot of work. Feels like a lot of things are in a weird spot. We want to watch, a lot of times when people want to sit up nice and tall, they think, I'm going to go ahead and pull my shoulders back. And then they'll come back into me, and they'll say, man, my neck is really tight, and I'm really sore between my shoulder blades. Well, now they've overcorrected. So it's not just pull the shoulder blades back, it's keep those shoulders out. So we keep that tube. I changed my tube when I did this. So I want to try to keep those shoulders out to the side. So then if we just go down our little checklist here, and by the way, if anybody wants this PowerPoint presentation for their own personal, I will share it with Marie and she can share it from there. I don't have any problems with that. So your feet are in parallel, firmly planted on the floor. Knees are positioned directly over the ankles. Thighs are parallel to the floor. Pelvis bowl positioned in neutral. Rib basket inside pelvic bowl. Shoulders over the pelvis bowl. Ears directly in line with the shoulders. So here, if everything is lined up and I take my head like this, now my ears aren't over my shoulders anymore. So we want to think of those ears right over here. When everybody take their hand right to their collarbone for me, right in front. Walk your fingers out to the side. When you come out to the side, you're right over by your shoulder. There's two bones that connect right here, your collarbone and your shoulder blade. They make this nice little point right out here on the side, and the ball of my shoulder sits directly under that point. That part never really changes, but my shoulder can. My shoulder can be too far in front of my point or too far behind my point, but my point never changes. So that's where we're just trying to get that ear. When I say shoulder, I mean that point right in there, on that shoulder in the middle. And then reaching the crown of the head to the ceiling. Now, as we sit here, it's nice to have back support. I want people to be able to have that back support. When you sit without back support, all of a sudden you start realizing there's a lot of muscles that have to work in order to hold you upright. So the more we can have that back support, it's nice, but we also want to make sure that we are moving around as well, but keeping that lift through the head. Now, whenever you take their right hand and bring it right on the top of their breastbone, and take their left hand and bring it right below the ribcage. Now, I want you to inhale through your nose and exhale through a small opening in your mouth. Inhale through your nose. And then exhale through a small opening in your mouth. Now, from here, I want you to do that again and think about which hand to move first. Take a nice inhale. And then let the air out. How many people have their right hand move first? Do you do this? Correct, she answered the question right. It's not supposed to. How many people have their bottom hand move first? Yeah? Now, it depends on the breath, on a little bit of that, but the goal is that we're using that diaphragm. Now, however, we have different actions within our ribcage of breath. So I want you to keep that right hand here, and as best as your shoulders will allow, bring that left hand right to the bottom of your ribcage. Now what I want you to try to do is do the same amount of breath to your front hand and your back hand. So you're gonna let that ribcage move a little forward, but also back, and let the air out. Inhale, and exhale. The better we can breathe back here, the better mobility in the spine we have in that stiff spot that a lot of us have in that middle part of the back. So what that's doing is that's reaching, that's getting the back part of your lungs, and it's the hardest one of the breathing. So those that have taken Pilates, Marie's worked a lot probably on getting you from potentially being too much of an upper neck breather and trying to get you down to your diaphragm and down to the lateral rib cage. Now the next horizon is adding this front to back breath with it. So as we do that, just kind of just bring your hands by your side, sit yourself into your chair, getting up nice and tall, let yourself lean back in your chair. So slide the legs back. Feeling that front of head reach up nice and tall. Find that nice inhale through your nose and think about that breath going back into your chair at the same time it's going out to either side of the room, and then exhale with the air out. Now some people might say as you start breathing this way, you start feeling a little dizzy. I'm giving you a lot of oxygen. But just be careful from there. Our body tells us to breathe not because we need oxygen, but because we have too much carbon dioxide. And if we breathe out of that small opening of our mouth, we're actually using the muscle of our rib cage to help get that air out. So it's a nice practice to get that movement, to get that airflow, and really get every morsel out and get all we can in. But that also helps with our posture. If we breathe, and now just everybody, just try this. Try to breathe from the top of your neck and just try to think of your ribcage going up. Feel how you don't get so much air? It's kind of like you get it and it's a little bit more of a, okay, I don't really have any more to get. I've got to get it from someplace else. So that also draws everything up, and now I have to change my posture in order to do that too. So the more we have that relaxation, we're able to use all of that ribcage, the better that skeleton lines up, and all of our muscles can be more efficient. So that's our sitting posture. Any questions on that one? This is how wide our hips are. So ladies, if you thought your hips were super wide, it's not your hips. It's the pelvis. I'm doing that one, but. So your hips are a lot more narrow, so that the head of the femur of that leg bone sits way in here, so it's just that little bit apart. Now when everybody is standing, shift their weight slightly front and slightly back. Just be careful with what you can. We want to make sure everybody stays upright today. So just shift front to back. And feel what that happens. Just kind of get a sense of skinning up your body as you shift front to back. Because all your weight is on your heels. Do you feel any pressure in your back, or in your neck, or any other part of the body? And as you come forward, do you feel some muscles turn on in the belly and the back? Just kind of get that sense of just that, what happens in that movement. Now find a place where you have a little bit more than half of your weight towards the front of your feet. So 60% towards the front of your feet. Now look down at your feet and look down at your toes. Now we're looking at, when I say the ball of your foot, That's the part just behind, just closer to your ankle from your toes. And now you're going to be looking at your weight's going to be even on the big toe side and in between the fourth and fifth toes. And just if you have your shoes off, or if you don't, check up on your toes. Are they gripping for dear life? Or are they relaxed? They should be nice and relaxed. Now, gently as you're standing here, roll the weight out towards the outside of your foot. Just feel what happens with your legs. And then roll them in slightly towards the inside of the foot. And feel what happens there. So just that little in and out makes a difference, just kind of up the leg. So now find that place where we have a little lift on the inside of the foot. We have that weight still balanced side to side, 60% to the front. Now everybody can take their legs, gently straighten them as much as you possibly can, and then release them just a little bit. That's keeping your knees soft. So if your legs, if you have a lot of tension in those leg muscles, either straightening them too much or bending them too much, you just want that little bit of softness. Now when we come up to your hips, this is where we want to think about that thigh bone. Is it rolled in, is it rolled out? If we set up our base well, it will be lined up well. So if I roll my legs in, they'll roll in. If I roll my feet in. If I roll my feet out, they'll roll out. So we want that straight line of that thigh bone straight up to the pelvis bowl. Now bring your hands onto your pelvis bowl. I want you to gently, keeping those feet where you have them, gently rock your bowl front to back again. And this may feel completely different than when you're standing. It just feels like a little bit different on your body. Now as you do this, we want to try to make it of your bowl and not the whole body getting involved. So just that little bowl rocking back and forth. As we have that, now we want to try, take your hand to your lower back, especially your shoulder blade level. Let your bowl go back and feel how that curve gets bigger. So the tailbone reaches back. Now tuck that bowl forward so your pubic bone goes forward. So I tell my clients this is like Steve Urkel from Family Matters position of every intersection. It's got an age limit. The teenagers nowadays don't really know what I'm talking about, so I gotta come up with another one. So then we gotta come right here. Now find that middle point. We have that alignment. And then as we look up here, I said a little bit that we have magnets in the legs. So we wanna feel that there's that energy of the legs coming together. Not that they're actually touching one another, but that the muscles are helping to hold us up. So I want everybody to just kind of let everything go. Okay, I'm feeling sore. Now, just think of your legs as being two magnets and try to squeeze them towards one another and feel what happens. And I saw it. Everybody got a little taller. So just by turning out a little bit of a muscle helps to take some of that pressure off. So we still do have muscles to support our bones, but we want to line those bones up as well. Now we talk about sitting, that rib basket staying inside your pelvis bowl. Same thing holds true in standing. And we want to keep that breastbone feeling like it's got a little balloon attached and it's reaching up towards the ceiling. But as we do that, we make sure that our rib basket stays inside the pelvic basket. So we don't let that balloon take us too far away. Then we have those shoulders, that shoulder tube, sitting over top. And then we have the top of the head, just like in sitting, reaching up towards the ceiling. So now we have that breath in here. So you inhale through your nose, and then exhale through your mouth. Inhale through your nose, and exhale through your mouth. One more time, inhale, and exhale. So how many people feel, as we breathe, as we're breathing, how many people feel different than when we first stood up? That's the same thing that they said. Just some different awarenesses. You'll find in your own body, there's things that feel different. And as one thing changes, something else changes. We become more aware of that. And that's that movement integration. We slowly integrate the things, the knowledge we have, and continue to apply it to other things. Thank you, Lisa. And you realize you bent that far forward to see it. So just knowing that you're kind of upright, and where do you adjust? So if you look down, if I look down, and everybody do this with me, if you take your chin and bring it forward in front of you, the shoulders have to follow, and then your spine follows, so everything kind of goes. But if you sit up tall and you gently bring your chin slightly towards your throat, everything stays tall, and you can still look down. You still see from there. So just those little awarenesses of where am I taking my tubes. So your head is kind of like the top So it's the top ball and all of these tubes to keep them stacked on top of one another. In line at the store, so as we're waiting in line, whether it's at the grocery store or at another register, if we have things in a cart, it's nice because we have a cart there and we can stand up. A lot of times if we stand for long periods of time, after a while, our weight gets on heels and we just sink down. So we want to try to stay tall so we keep that weight forward, but then after a while it's like, man, this is really getting tiring. So another option you can do in standing is put one foot a little in front of the other. And that keeps your weight balanced. So what I did is I put my one foot so the arch lands up on the toes of my other foot. And it doesn't matter what you have going up this way. So I put one foot a little bit like that. So a little split stance. And then you can do the same thing. It doesn't matter which foot's in front. But now you have that weight balanced on both feet. So just that little adjustment, all of a sudden it doesn't feel so, I'm getting heavy. So then you can stand up nice and tall. So that's a nice thing to do in the store. Another thing in the bathroom, kind of going through there, and again, I'm going to caution on this one, it depends on your household and how you feel comfortable. You can open the cabinet and gently place your foot in the cabinet instead of on a stool, and that will kind of keep you upright as well. Some people don't like that because they don't want the pressure on the cabinets, but you're not really stepping on it. It's just a little resting position, and you can change your feet. So that keeps you also tall. So again, it keeps you from wanting to lower down low. In the kitchen. So in the kitchen, that's also another place that you're moving around potentially quite a bit, going from the refrigerator, maybe to the stove, microwave, sink, different things. If you're standing at the sink for a while in the kitchen, same sort of thing, putting your foot in place also helps that posture underneath the cabinet, or standing with that little split stance. And then as you go forward to wash, you're not doing this. If your shoulders go, your head goes, and vice versa. So if everything goes forward like this, get compressed and everything rolls forward. So the idea is how can we line all those things upright? And the other parts of the kitchen is reaching and lowering. So now we've got movement, right? Because now we have to get things out of the dishwasher, put things into the laundry or doing other things. So how do we get that movement integration? So what does proper posture look like when you're getting something down? So now we have to take into consideration a couple things. What's our knee health like? What's our spine health like? So somebody that has knee issues won't like me if I tell them they have to bend down to get things all the time. Somebody that has a bad back for some things won't like me to tell them potentially to do a little golfer's hinge at times because that might be too hard. They're not quite organized in their abdominal muscles. But you have options. You have this nice little teeter-totter, little dinky bird kind of movement. And then we also have our little squat. And so when we squat down, I'm going to kind of come to the center as well. I don't like to tell people to put their feet side by side, because then this is what happens. They go here, and the butt sticks out, and they don't know how they're going to get back up, and everything goes to the back. So I like to tell people to put one foot a little bit in front of the other, and then they can go ahead and lower down here. Now everything stays up tall. And it doesn't matter which foot's in front, the one that's in back ends up the heel will lift off the ground. Otherwise, it makes it very difficult to kind of do the movement, or maybe it's just tightness in the calf muscle that keeps that movement. But just that little bit changes, and now we're going down an imaginary wall in the back. Now, when you have to lift up something heavy, it's best to get something else done. But as you do things, I mean, we want to avoid this nice forward bend that we like to do in Pilates and do things. It's like, oh, we're going to just melt forward.